Will democracy survive the next couple of years?
And essentially, we are the same.
Can't have government choosing winners or losers.
There are so many needs that Minnesota has.
What people are saying they need right now.
Access to Democracy is made possible in part by a donation from Firefly Credit Union. Firefly is the new name of U.S. Federal Credit Union, which has proudly served the financial needs of the greater Twin Cities community since 1925. At Firefly, we guide our members forward and give them the power to chase dreams by delivering the financial solutions they need to get ahead. From checking accounts to mortgages, we'll light the way. We are Firefly Credit Union, and this is Life Illuminated. By Thomson Reuters, providing legal professionals with intelligence, technology, and human expertise they need to find trusted answers. Thomson Reuters, the answer company. Online at thomsonreuters.com. And Dr. Charles Crutchfield of award-winning Crutchfield Dermatology in Eagan. Acknowledged as one of the nation's best physicians, a Minnesota native who trained at the Mayo Clinic, Dr. Crutchfield personally treats all patients and states that experience counts and quality matters. Crutchfield Dermatology, look good, feel great, with beautiful skin.
Welcome. Access to Democracy returns. Alan Miller with you, a first-time guest, although I don't know why he is a first-time guest, but Senator Greg Clausen of Senate District 57, and welcome.
Thank you, Alan.
You have an incredible background and credentials. You have been a teacher. You have been a principal. You have been a coach, among other things. I know you got your BA at Augsburg, and you went to the University of St. Thomas, where you got several degrees, if I'm not mistaken.
Two degrees, you're correct, Al, yeah.
So you have not quite as many degrees as a thermometer, but... now, I was speaking to another senator about a week ago and mentioned that you were going to be on today, and he said, wow, you have got the guy who knows more about education than anybody in the legislature. He's our educational guru. So we certainly have a lot to talk about in that regard.
Very good.
And the education legislator is the way you were described to me. But you do other things. Now, you have just had a bill passed, if I'm not mistaken, allowing DNR officers to write DWI citations. Talk about that.
Well, that's an interesting one. This goes back to 2018, where a constituent contacted me who had just lost his brother in a traffic fatality. His brother was driving to northern Wisconsin with two friends, and they were hit head-on Interstate 94 by a person traveling the wrong way at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And the fellow was huffing ultra duster, which is a common aerosol that used for cleaning, computer parts and so on. And he was contacting me because he said if that had happened here in Minnesota, that the gentleman that hit them and survived, all three others were dead at the scene, he could not be charged with a DWI in Minnesota. And he was contacting me saying, we need to do something about this. So I started doing some history on the situation and found that we had a very archaic system. We had, you could be arrested for DWI for alcohol, for illegal drugs, but then you got to a third category of intoxicating substances, and we were using an OSHA standard. When OSHA, of course, is
the federal standard.
Federal standard for industrial standards. And so every time we found a new category, a new chemical that would cause an inability for a person to function at a normal rate, you had to add that to the list. And if the item was not on the list, a person could not be charged. So we initiated the bill. I worked with the Minnesota DWI task force made up of about 40 people from nonprofit groups like Moms Against Drunk Driving, DNR officers, state troopers, local police, prosecuting attorneys, defense attorneys. And I worked with that group. We crafted a bill, and it was successful.
And it was passed into law.
And it was passed into law. And so we no longer have that OSHA standard, but we have a definition of what an intoxicating substance is. And so whenever we have an issue, that definition falls into place.
Well, it's interesting also because a DNR officer could make an arrest for a crime, but couldn't issue a citation at that time. Yeah. So you've overcome that also.
Yeah, from that work last year, I met a DNR officer, and he brought this up to me. He said, you know, that DNR officers cannot make a DWI arrest on a roadway. They can do it on state trails for people that are in four-wheelers. They can do it for boating, snowmobiles, and so on. But once they were in a vehicle, they could stop if they saw suspicious activity in driving, but then they'd have to call a local county sheriff or a state trooper, and they'd have to sit there and wait until that other officer
which
came.
Which makes absolutely no sense at all.
Not
and then
all.
The other officer, if the case ever went to trial, would be asked, did you see this person? What caused you to pull him over? And he would say, well, no, I'm going on the word of a DNR officer, and that's probably enough to get a case thrown out of court.
That was a problem, and then the DNR officer many times would have to appear along with, let's say, a state trooper or county sheriff. So that is right now in the Judiciary Committee. It's in their omnibus bill, and so we're hoping that that's going to be passed into law this year.
We certainly hope so.
Yeah.
And you are a person who listens to your constituents, and when they say something to you and suggest that something that needs correcting, I have learned that you act on it. For instance, you spoke to a truck driver who said, I can't, with my truck, with my 52-foot trailer, I can't travel in a roundabout and stay in one lane.
Yeah.
So what did you do?
Yeah, that's an interesting situation. That this person, he was driving down in the Mankato area, and he was actually pulled over by a county sheriff for taking two lanes as he went through a roundabout. And I met with the gentleman. I started doing some research. I contacted the Trucking Association. We developed a bill, and we were successful, and the bill is moving forward right now in the legislature. So we hope that's going to change.
So that there will have to be an exception for a truck which can't really travel in a roundabout because the roundabout is not made wide enough or not big enough for a truck to stay in one lane as it's going through there.
Exactly. And the other thing I learned, in a lot of roundabouts, they have a little cup on the inside. That supposedly was to help a truck that they could go up on that. But then what's happened is we've had some trucks tip over because of that. It's a trailer gets up on that ridge, and then they tip over, and we've had some of those situations too.
That certainly would make a mess.
Yes, definitely.
Yes. Now, one of the things I know that you've been very involved in is guns for teachers and or in the classroom, and you certainly have some very definite opinions about that. We could talk about guns in general because I know that you're for background checks and I don't know what else, and probably stopping gun sales at these gun rallies or whatever they call them. But go into that in terms of guns for teachers. I mean, you were there. You were on the fire. Fortunately, we haven't had an incident like that in Minnesota with one of these multiple killings. But you were in the classroom.
Yeah.
You were a coach. Yeah. You were a principal. So let's approach the question of guns.
Well, the last shooting we had was in Red Lake, where we did have multiple, if you may recall that, a few years ago. But I was a principal at the time when the Columbine shootings took place. And that changed the lives, I think, of all educators and administrators. We suddenly had to deal with the thought that your school could be next. I think there's a lot of issues connected with that. District 196, Rosemont Apple Valley Eagan Public Schools, passed a bond 2 years ago, and they've done a lot of work on the entrances to the schools, making them more secure. I think an issue that's overlooked, and if you go talk to school counselors, they will be the first ones to talk about, we need to do more for mental health issues in our schools. We need to provide mental health professionals to deal with some of the issues that young people are dealing with. So I think there's a number of things that we can do to strengthen schools, to make them safer from a physical standpoint, and a lot of schools are doing that. Working with the Minnesota School Safety Center, they will provide technical assistance to schools. They'll sit down and do tabletop exercises with local police, school officials, emergency personnel, simulating situations and how would they react. You mentioned the issue about arming teachers. I don't think that would be a wise idea. I don't think that's should be part of a teacher's job description. I think the putting guns in classrooms would be just looking for an accident sometime to happen. If you have a shooting and police are coming in and now you have a person that they run across who is a teacher that has a gun in their hand, that can provide another misfortune.
We have seen more than once where a person who is a victim but has a gun in their hand actually gets shot because the police upon the scene, adrenaline is pumping very high. They burst into the scene. They see a person with a gun. Perhaps they fire, perhaps they shout, drop it, and it gets miscommunicated or not heard. And the next thing you know, the person with the gun who was one of the good guys ends up as one of the dead guys.
Yeah. And I just, there was a report just last week in the state of Louisiana. There was a substitute teacher in a classroom, elementary, who had a gun in his pocket and it dropped out and misfired. That's just one example of what could occur.
And it could have taken out a student.
Absolutely.
I think that teachers really have enough on their plate. They're underpaid enough as it is. Most teachers are buying their own supplies, that they don't have to worry about, even if they're given a gun, learning how to use it and becoming a marksman and putting themselves in harm's way in that regard.
Yeah. I don't think it has any place in our schools, arming teachers.
What else can we do about school security, though, to really beef things up and make sure our children are protected?
Well, I think being prepared, collaborating with your local police department, your emergency personnel, going through and training school personnel on how to react to situations, and that would be for teachers in the classroom as well as administrators and others. I think
going into these lockdown situations?
Lockdown situations. I think that one of the things that we've done here in the metro area in particular about school resource officers. These are trained officers from the local police departments that are in the school. They serve two purposes. One would just be relationships, establishing relationships with students so that students come to understand that this is a person that I can come and see and talk with if I have concerns. And then also they're there for security if that is a need as well.
What about police in each school? Do you think that every school should have a police officer assigned to it as opposed to a resource officer?
Well, the school resource officers are trained. They are actually police officers. They are part of the local police department. So they are trained. They carry a firearm. They are just like any police officer you would encounter on the street that's on patrol.
See, that's something that I wasn't aware of. When I heard resource officer, I assumed that it's a civilian and not a police officer.
Yeah. Sometimes they're called police liaison officers, but school resource officers are kind of a common term right now.
And then making it harder, of course, to get into schools.
Yes.
I mean, you know, I think back to, well, to my youth, I'm thinking of walking to the log cabin, but we used to walk in and out of school, you know, all the time, and kids would take off for a class and go out and, and those days smoke a cigarette in the athletic field and come back and things like that. We can't do that anymore.
Preparedness is big, and then also when I worked for the Rosemont Apple Valley Eagan Public Schools in the central office, I was responsible for developing a school safety plan for the district. And I mentioned the School Resource Center. They were a big help to me as far as sitting down and talking about what are the components for a safety plan. I do have a bill this session to provide some additional funding for that School Resource Center. There are only three people that are part of that public safety department, the School Resource Center. They were cut back from a fourth position. I'm restoring the fourth and adding a fifth person. Last year they served 225 schools going into communities, assessing strengths in schools as far as their security. I mentioned doing tabletop exercises with local community officials. You know, those are all part of being prepared if indeed you have to deal with a tragedy that other communities have had around this nation.
And you also mentioned mental health grants in terms of identifying students who have problems, because if we can get them early before that problem exacerbates, we can avoid tragedy. So would that be state money coming in?
It would be. I authored a bill back in 2015 to provide grants. School district would apply for those grants that would help them have mental health professionals in their buildings. Also, there's a school safety levy. This is a levy that local schools can, school boards can actually levy money without going to the public. There is a cap on it.
Would that be the Safe Schools Levy Bill?
Yes, the Safe Schools Levy Bill that I have, where I'm trying to increase that cap so they have a little bit more money. And District 196 uses that money for school counselors, mental health, prevention programs, social workers in our elementary schools. And so that would be one way, again, providing resources that local school districts would have control over, local control and by the Board of Education to make those decisions.
Yeah, I was surprised to learn that a lot of schools don't have social workers. And particularly in some of the smaller districts and some of the outstate districts where, you know, it's needed there just as much as it's needed anyplace else.
Absolutely.
So we have a session of the legislature, and as I was talking to Senator Jensen, that's winding down now. It seems that everything goes so slowly at the beginning and then gets lumped in at the end. Many times to the detriment of the legislators and to the people of the state. One of the things I know that's contentious is the gas tax. The governor is very much in favor of a gas tax. He wanted a 20-cent gas tax. Where is that proposal at the moment, and do you see it succeeding?
Well, that's a good question. It's moving along in the House to some degree. We have not had a hearing in the Senate. In the minority, we don't have control over that. But the gas tax, I think we've all experienced some difficulty with some of our roads and our road system. But one of the starting points to talk about the gas tax is something I share with people a lot, and that is that Minnesota is the 18th largest state geographically. We have the 22nd largest population of the 50 states, but we have the fifth largest road system. And when you think about that,
that's a pretty surprising statistic.
It is, isn't it? And then you think about all the bridges, because we have streams, rivers. Think about all the bridges across the Mississippi River just here in the Twin Cities.
Well, we know what can happen with a defective bridge.
We do.
Yeah. And certainly that tragedy in I-35 is something that's still very fresh in everybody's mind.
Well, the 20-cent gas tax, too, there's a 6.5 cents of that goes back to the 2017 tax bill that was signed and passed into law. We pay a sales tax on car parts. Every time we go and have an accident and we have to replace car parts, there's a tax. That tax at one time went to the general fund. In 2017, the law changed that, and those dollars went to transportation, which left a hole in the general fund. Of course, the general fund pays for health and human services, education, higher education, nursing homes, any number of things. What Governor Walz has proposed is we want to switch that back into the general fund. So 6.5 of that 20 cents is actually to change those dollars back into the general fund. Every cent that the gas tax is increased, it's $30 million, which is a lot of money. But when you look at the Department of Transportation, they believe we've got about a $600 billion bill if we are to repair all of our bridges to make them up to a safe standard and our roads.
Not only bridges, but it's the roads. It's the potholes. Yeah. I remember when David Letterman was on television, he used to joke that he hit a pothole that was so big that it had a pharmacy at the bottom of it. and I've hit a couple lately that are not that big, but they certainly can do damage to your car, even if you're going slowly. Yeah. And infrastructure is so important.
Absolutely.
And it's one of the things that we allow to get away from us. And in the long run, it ends up costing us more money.
It's very true, very true. And it's something that we've let slide over the years, and now to try to catch up, it just, as you mentioned, is just so much more expensive. But I'm hopeful that a gas tax is something that we can compromise on. Maybe it's not 20 cents, but somewhere in between, and that we can provide some additional funding for our transportation system, which moves goods and services across the state. The agriculture industry is so dependent upon our rural highways. It's something we need to address.
One of many things that's still left on the table. Yeah. What's left on the table education-wise that we haven't dealt with yet?
Well, higher education, the House just released their requests, what they're looking at. They would like to freeze tuition at the University of Minnesota and Minnesota State systems. So that's one of the things. They also want to increase the Minnesota grant program for low-income students to help them achieve an education, higher education. That grant proposal also does a couple other things. It changes the requirements for students and families as far as what their contribution is to be. And we want to move that up perhaps into middle class, so we have some middle class families that are struggling with that, that we could do that. We know that our educated workforce is perhaps our greatest asset here in the state of Minnesota. And at one time, perhaps when you and I were in school and college, the state paid 75% of a student's tuition. That was a requirement. Right now, we're paying about 42%. And so the difference is being made up through tuition increases.
Some of the tuitions are really frightening. You know, I read an article yesterday with average tuition, I don't remember which school it was $57,000 a year. I mean, really, albeit you maybe get grant and aid, maybe you get a loan, maybe you have some scholarship money, it's still a frightening figure.
Absolutely.
I don't want to say how old I am, but although I have more rings around my trunk than a sequoia, but when I was accepted to Syracuse, tuition was $250 a semester. Before I went to start my year, it was raised $25. So it was then $2, and that made an impact.
Yeah.
So I can't even fathom, although my own children have gone through the system, $57,000 a year. It's really frightening.
Yeah, in those days, you and I, we could work during the summer. I know when I started at Augsburg University, it was $1,000 for the year for your tuition. I could take as many credits as I wanted. It was $1,000. And if I paid, I think, $50 more, it was locked in for 4 years. And I could make $1,000 in the summer. Students nowadays, they can't make $18,000 during
the
summer.
No, they certainly can't.
No.
And I can think back to some of the summer jobs that I had. Yeah. And it did help, but we've gotten away from that.
Yeah. Yeah.
In fact, we're first beginning to attack the minimum wage in an intelligent way. Mm-hmm. And so as we run down the last few minutes, and we're down to our last 2 minutes, I see, what are the big issues that you see left for the legislature to tackle this year?
Well, we haven't talked about the E-12, early education through grade 12, so let's maybe concentrate on that. There's a couple things that are still there. One of the things that we've talked a great deal about, and we had hearings over the summer and the fall, is the cross-subsidy for special education. In 1974, when the Individual Disabilities Education Act was passed, the federal government committed that they would pay 40% of those costs. They've never met that, and right now in Minnesota, it's 7% of the costs. And so general fund dollars are being shifted to pay for special education. In Rosemont Apple Valley public schools, it's like $23 million, $24 million a year. And that has a big impact on the school budget.
They have to end up having a levy if necessary.
Exactly.
To raise the money, and it's on the back of the property owners.
Yeah.
So,
and I don't want to pit special education students against other students. It's a federal law. They deserve to have an equal education and have their needs met. But the federal government has never lived up to their responsibility. I've worked with Angie Craig at the federal level. She's taken this on. She wants to make the federal government commit to that. So we've actually had a public hearing a couple weeks ago, and so we're working together to try to make that change. And she's a great partner in the federal government to make that happen.
Our new very active and very aggressive congresswoman.
Yeah.
And very good.
Yeah.
Now, we've been talking with Senator Greg Clausen and Senate District 57. Some reason you have been only a first-time guest, but you're certainly not going to be a last-time guest.
I look forward to
and,
that.
And we will have you back because there's so many other things to talk about. And maybe a few months from now we can look back on the session and talk about what we did and didn't accomplish. Thank you so much for coming in.
Thank you, Alan. The time goes fast.
It goes fast.